Questions. And today's topic is Chapter 12 of Parker Moore, and we're going to be going over ethics, and we're also going to discuss law, and then religion. And I have a little treat for everyone. We're going to have my former professor of religious studies, Dr. Robert Eisenman, who's written tons of books, appear on TV all over the place, teaches at California State University, Long Beach. We'll come in after our break to discuss religion in detail. So right now we just need to finish up deontology and in terms of our ethics. And then we go into legal reasoning, and we can do religion. Okay, now, deontology, of course, is very different from utilitarianism, which we discussed last time, okay? But it is still part of the Enlightenment, okay? So in the time of the Enlightenment, the time of the Age of Reason, there was a considerable amount of debate in politics and in ethics, lots of philosophers, okay? And the claimants of the Enlightenment were to those of democracy, freedom, human dignity, human rights, scientific progress, optimism, and to some extent at least human equality. There was a great deal of confidence, of course, in reason and in liberalism. Okay. This was the time also of the revolution, so these thinkers' thoughts often led to the revolutions, the American Revolution, the French Revolution, the Haitian Revolution, and eventually even the Russian Revolution. Okay. So this was all the time of the Enlightenment, and all of these revolutions were in line with the commitments of the Enlightenment. May I have clip number one, please?
One of the most absolute of Europe's absolute rulers. Louis XIV ruled over France from 1643 to 1750. Louis, like other rulers before and after him, believed that a king was God's instrument on earth, ruling by authority of divine will. But the Age of Enlightenment would challenge this idea. 13 years after Louis XIV died, and during the reign of Louis XV, a traveler returned to his home here at Le Bret, near Bordeaux, France. Baron de Montesquieu, a French nobleman and judge, had visited many parts of the world, and now, in 1728, he had begun to set down his thoughts. On and off for nearly 20 years, he wrote what would become his greatest work, in which he opposed the divine rights of kings with the natural rights of the common man. At last, one evening in 1748, as was the custom of the times, Montesquieu gathered a committee of his friends and read his completed work aloud to them for their opinion before publishing it. De l'esprit des lois, chapitre premier. Des lois dans le rapport qu'elles ont avec les divers êtres. Des lois dans la signification la plus étendue. As part of his work, The Spirit of the Laws, Montesquieu had studied many governments and concluded that a government like that in England was closest to an ideal government. It was a government whose powers were separated into three branches, the executive, legislative, and judicial. Each division checked and balanced.
Okay, as I said, in the Enlightenment, there's a considerable amount of debate about politics and ethics, and a move against monarchies and authoritarianism and towards constitutional and parliamentary systems of government. Okay, so also goes towards capitalism, towards the scientific revolution, and of course, the traditions of revising ethics, and it's a secular form rather than simply by means of religion. Before all the various commitments of the Enlightenment, there was, as I said, a lot of debate, okay? And we saw that already last time with the utilitarians and their contribution to the Enlightenment, okay? And the utilitarians, of course, took some of their ideas from David Hume, and David Hume was an earlier philosopher who was a skeptic, not only a skeptic with respect to science, but a skeptic with respect to ethics, okay? Now, that then is where we get deontology, Hume was a skeptic of ethics, and Kant read Hume and his afternoon Hume concept. Oops. Hume woke me up from my dogmatic slumber. Okay, because what was Hume saying in respect to ethics? He was saying that ethics were simply a matter of social conditioning, feelings, okay, social norms, education, and basic human survival, okay, and of course the learning of empathy. But Hume said, okay, that there were no absolute norms, okay, as it was quite contrary to what had been brought up by the religion, okay, and quite contrary to the commitments of the Enlightenment. So in order to save the Enlightenment, its commitments, particularly with respect to ethics and politics, Kant knew he had to do something, okay? Because ethics cannot simply be a matter of feelings or social conditioning, or perhaps you get an education, or perhaps you come from a good family, and it cannot simply be reduced to cultural norms and mores, okay? Although it certainly is a matter of human survival, okay? But in the Hume system, there was no foundation for ethics, no higher or objective or universal rules to govern ethical behavior from society to society, and therefore there will be human rights or human dignity on a universal scale. So Kant certainly had his work cut out for him, given his commitments to the Enlightenment. Okay, so Immanuel Kant reads Hume, and he sits down and he starts to do some work, not only in defending how science is possible, but in showing the fact how a universal ethics is possible for all human beings everywhere, regardless of their society. This is what Kant was trying to do, and he succeeded in many ways. Now, Kant found utilitarianism deficient, and therefore he developed his own theory, which we call duty theory or deontology. The word deon comes from Greek, meaning duty. Okay? There are many things, of course, that we should do, many things that we have a duty for. For example, I should go to work, I should take care of my family. Okay? I have work goals. Okay? I have a number of other responsibilities. These are also my obligations and duties. However, these kinds of duties fell in what Kant calls hypothetical imperatives. Okay? Hypothetical imperatives are conditional imperatives. I have a duty here and a duty there, but they are conditional, okay? And they are situational, okay? They often get involved by feelings, my personal relationships, such as friendship, okay? They are things in which I can actively engage in order to obtain certain kinds of goals or results, okay? Hypothetical imperatives, therefore, are not ethical imperatives, okay? They involve things like what might be pleasant or convenient or advantageous to me, or are my certain social responsibilities, like at work or at home, okay? By contrast, ethical imperatives are what we call categorical. Categorical means, rather than being situational, they are unconditional, okay? They are applied universally at all times, instead of hypothetically, where they apply from situation to situation. So, what is a categorical imperative? Something that's universal, something that's imperative, meaning it's telling you you must, you should, you ought, okay, so it's a commandment, okay, and it's your duty, this is what you should do, this is what you must do, period, okay, regardless of your situation or your feelings or what's advantageous to you, regardless of the consequences. So it's being very different than utilitarianism. Okay? You're not concerned so much with what are the advantages or the consequences to your action, but with your motivations to do what is right simply because it is the right thing to do. Okay? To do what is right because it is a matter of your duty, and your duty is dictated by reason. Okay? So it is not a result simply of your feelings. Okay? It is a matter of your having a good will do what's right, because it is your duty. Okay? So, it is what is your moral intentions that are praiseworthy, not the consequences of your actions. It is your moral duty to do what is right, regardless of the fact of the consequences, because what your moral duty is simply doing the right thing. Okay? Now, how can we tell what our duty is, what we are supposed to do? Okay? Some would base our duty on God's commandments, while others would base it upon reason. And others would base it, of course, on their definition of what human nature is. Now, all of these things, God's commandments, what you understand by reason, okay, and what you consider human nature to be, are, of course, open for debate throughout the history of philosophy. Okay. Kant argued that our moral duties are dictated by the categorical imperative. Okay? And Kant formulates the categorical imperative in a number of ways, okay? But it essentially boils down to two basic rules. One, treat your maxim, by maxim means your rule, your principle, or your law, okay, as a universal maxim for all humankind. Hence, if you are about to make a moral decision, you must ask the principle that I'm making this decision on. I must ask myself questions like, what if everyone did this? If everyone was just supposed to do that, and that would be the rational and reasonable thing to do, then that is what I'm commanded to do. If on the other hand, I'm going to be inconsistent and say, it's okay for me to do this, but I wouldn't want other people to do this, then I'm acting irrationally and I am violating the categorical imperative. It's essential then to ask yourself this question, what if everybody did it, okay? And would this be the thing everyone ought to do in this situation? Is this the reasonable, rational, moral thing to do in this situation, okay? Kant now, of course, assumes that we are all capable of reason, okay? And that given the same circumstances and given the fact that we are all capable of reason, we would certainly all will the same thing, that our concept of good would be universalizable, that is to say, it would apply to all people everywhere in this situation, okay? That is, of course, if you reason it through. So the maxim is essentially universalizable. The second principle of the categorical imperative is to treat all persons as ends in themselves, including, of course, yourself, and not merely as means or as tools, okay? Each person simply by being a person, simply by being a person of any sort, black, white, tall, short, old, young, male, female, Chinese, Russian, American, whatever, okay, is worthy of dignity and has certain inalienable rights, okay, and are ends in themselves, okay, they cannot simply be used as a mean, you cannot simply exploit them or take advantage of them, okay, and it has nothing to do with their social standing, nothing to do with whether they're convenient to you or not, nothing to do with how you feel about them, okay, whether you like them or not, okay, and this is regardless of your feelings towards them. It is simply, they are another person, and they have certain inalienable rights, and they have dignity, and they are due, okay, respect. That is your first duty, okay? The results of Kant's categorical imperative are therefore quite different from that of utilitarianism, where not everyone is treated equally. In utilitarianism also, you are directly seeking the results of happiness. Here you want to produce happiness for the greatest number. Okay, whereas in deontology, happiness for humanity can only be indirectly rather than directly intended, okay? You are not out there looking at utilitarianism looking for the consequences of thoughts. You are looking for the intentions, the motive, your reasons for how you act and how you make your decisions, and what principle are you acting by. Okay, so may we have clip number two, please?
Strengths and effect. Everyone is treated as a moral and dignity in worth, intolerance, and rational. That stress was remedied as having anyone be moral unless they make their own decisions. It's a decision procedure. Know your intention, you don't know the consequences of your action. Intention brings up examples like the moon's might. It could be given a mandatory or rank in society. But consequences, you also want the results to reach faster. And you're not a bad person due to the consequences you have had. Goodwill is the only good thing. Doing your duty, showing morality is not just based on feelings. Catechism is stress is the importance of reason. You can't ask why should I be rational, because that's reasoning in itself. Even since the catechism make clear that it is possible to universalize contradictory things, such as do not lie and lie to relieve suffering. Catechism can tell us in this case what we should not do, but when rules are effective, it doesn't tell us what we should do. Again, there is no ranking system in the importance of rules. Another end of the spectrum ignores consequences entirely. Surely you should take into account itself. Are you not somewhat responsible for the wrong of human nature not to consider the consequences? If one woman puts a gun to her head and asks for your friend's address, surely you would realize the consequences of tearing that address, whether or not you intended to die. If feeling sympathy if someone is falling over and up, acting upon it is irrelevant in making a decision. Why is it duty a reason you should do it? Should you help someone out of compassion? That describes how we actually act in an overly academic manner. Furthermore, also informed of the fact that if someone helped another woman rape a person upon a manifestation of the imperative, then they would be wrong. But if someone did the same under a categorical imperative, then they would be right. And under what regime or orders is doing your duty acceptable? Kant says it's never unacceptable. Surely that's hypothetical, doing something because someone says it's correct. Kant seems to be contradicting himself. There's also the idea that Kantians are too precious. A family member asks for help with euthanasia, like giving great pain, so you can't possibly simply do your duty. Surely that's a bit precious. Kantians are absolutists and do not consider the consequences. Empiricists, such as utilitarians, would say that the a priori aspect ignores human nature. Surely morality has something to do with happiness. David Hume, a philosopher, said that reason is the slave of the passions. Your reason will do something based on what you feel about it. Therefore, not everyone can be reasonable. People will always do what they feel is right or wrong. However, all these criticisms are of the first formulation of universal law, but will the others even revise your answer? The principle of double effect is that for something to be wrong, there must be two effects. You must intend something as well as doing it. The consequences say that you must consider all consequences and not the intention.
As you can see, there are, well, both utilitarianism, Kant, Hume, and Mill, and Bentham, are committed to the Enlightenment, and Kant, too, is committed to the Enlightenment. They really lock horns in terms of what they think the ethical principles should be by which we make our choices, okay? So utilitarianism, as you know, is not so concerned with your motives as it is with the results of the effects which can be measured, presumably, and which are empirical, okay? And utilitarianism does not treat everyone equally. Minorities have rights, but those rights are not to interfere with the rights of the greatest number. And so if the minority thinks that they have rights to assert something that's going to cause pain or unhappiness to the majority, then the minority is in the wrong, okay? Whereas deontology must simply do what is right because it's right. You're supposed to treat people equally, regardless of feelings, okay? Regardless of personal advantage, okay, and even without regard, directly at least, for the consequences, okay? You're simply to do your duty because it is your duty. Again, also, Kant, he of course does not expect everyone to be interested in following the categorical imperative, empirically, factually, okay? But he says that we are all perfectly capable, universally capable, of achieving the same notion of reason and rationality, okay? Kant has a lot of weaknesses, for example, with, as was mentioned, conflicting duties, okay? Okay, so on the one hand, Kant believes that all people acting rationally would reach a consensus about what their duty was. On the other hand, there are conflicting duties, and it might not be so easy sometimes to sort out how to resolve these kinds of conflicts. Okay, Kant stresses human rationality, human autonomy, our fundamental and human rights, okay, which transcend one's society, feelings, social conditioning, cultural norms, and so on. Okay? So clearly Kant is opposed to any kinds of relativism. Okay? Relativism would absolutely not work. That would be hypothetical rather than categorical. Okay? There are your duties. Your duties apply regardless of your situation. It is the moral theory that you must do. Okay? And that's it for Kant, right? So, let's give a little comparison and contrast. Suppose you're a utilitarian, okay? You would say that there was more means of obtaining scientific information by the Nazi experiments. We went over this a little bit last class, okay? But some of the information obtained by the Nazi scientists, certainly not all, okay, that information could be beneficial, okay, for us today. And the utilitarians would then say, since the information gathered by the Nazis, however atrocious their methods of human experimentation, since that information could be beneficial, we should use it today. Where deontology would say, absolutely not, that material was acquired with horrific violations of human rights and basic human dignity. It treated people as means or as tools rather than as ends in themselves, and therefore the information, however useful or beneficial, cannot be used on principle. The same thing with natural law theory and virtue ethics. They would also say an evil means was used to achieve some kind of good end, and therefore it has to be thrown out. So they cannot use this information or knowledge that was acquired through evil means. okay. The ontology would argue for a very strong safety net to society, so people were treated equally, okay, or at least have equal opportunity. Whereas utilitarianism, while also stressing the importance of a safety net in society, first of all, especially for those that are unfortunate, it would stress the rights of the majority. It would stress the rights of your normal life expectancy, normal opportunity range, but you would not have entitlements beyond a certain level of benefit to society as a whole. And if there was no benefit, then utilitarianism would say that we would be obligated to give you treatment because, let's say, if you're very old, you're probably not going to be able to benefit society anymore. Okay? Deontology, by contrast, stresses self-legislation, self-determination, and autonomy to a much greater extent than utilitarianism, okay, which would be more paternalistic, okay, where for utilitarianism, minority rights can be sacrificed if that were to benefit the greatest number. Again, I'll go back. Both systems were committed to the Enlightenment, okay, and both systems will disagree with moral relativism. But each ethical system has produced very different results. For instance, a deontologist would support universal national health coverage, okay, regardless of one's age or financial situation, whereas utilitarianism would provide you with a moral opportunity range beyond which society would not owe you anything if society could not benefit from continuing treatment for you. Okay? Given the scarce resources of society, utilitarianism would favor those most likely to benefit society in the future rather than the rights of any particular individual over the community. A decision made by Churchill, I think I may have mentioned this before, at Dartmouth in the war, was when the Nazis invaded to withdraw the able-bodied soldiers first to save them so they could fight on, and if needs be, to leave the injured soldiers back, I mean, because they would no longer be able to fight. Churchill's decision was a utilitarian decision and definitely not a deontological decision, okay? So, both systems, of course, would obviously have certain kinds of objections to our laissez-faire capitalist system, in which there are some winners, a few, and many losers, okay? Often people are losers in the capitalist system through no fault of their own, as sometimes winners are winners through no merit of their own, okay? So, it would be critical of both systems, okay? Now, both systems also, okay, are concerned with human happiness. They are concerned with human happiness. But utilitarianism is directly concerned with human happiness, whereas Kant's system is indirectly concerned with human happiness. Here's the issue, okay? Now, if you're a good person, if you're a person of goodwill in Kant's system, and you do what is right because it is right, you may suffer bad negative consequences as a result of doing your moral duty. Then you would have to ask, why would I do my moral duty when it is disadvantageous for me to follow through? Kant therefore has to insert God and immortality into his system to show that the moral order in the universe, in our hearts, and in our minds works out anyway, and that we should have a rational faith. How does that happen? Okay. A person of goodwill, a person who does what is right because it is right, rationally should expect happiness, but not necessarily here in the empirical order, okay, in the factual world where misfortunes can happen. And therefore, he inserts God to grant you immortality, that your expectation of happiness may not be fulfilled here on earth, but in the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of heaven is beyond. Okay? And so, okay, that's what God does. All right, by throwing in immortality and saying that solves the ethical problem. So, for example, suppose I was in the Nazi regime and I was hiding Jews in the basement. And the SS came over to me, knocked on my door, and wanted to know what I was doing. And I lied to them. Okay? And I said, I don't know any Jews, no Israel. Okay? And I put myself at risk because I could wind up being caught, as well as my family at risk. And I too could very well wind up in a concentration camp. Okay? But I did my duty. I did what was right. I'm simply suffering the consequences of doing what is right. In order to make sense out of that, Kant then says, there is God. Okay? Even with the possibility of negative consequences. My duty is to do what is right, and immortality is the way I'm finally granted my happiness, and it's not obtained here on Earth, which is often very difficult to obtain happiness here on Earth and also be a good person. Now, God's ethics had a wide influence, it still is very influential in many discussions today in ethics, okay, such as that of the philosophy of Rawls in his book, The Theory of Justice, and also by the French existentialist philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre, okay, who was part of the French Resistance movement during World War II, okay, and he makes use of Kant's ethics, okay, by arguing that one had an obligation to stand up for human freedom, dignity, human rights, regardless of the consequences. Sartre then went on to become himself a Marxist, okay, because Marx continue the commitments of the Enlightenment, no longer simply to civil rights or civil freedoms, but Marx clearly extended human rights and human dignity to economics and to the workplace, because if you're going hungry, and if you're poor, okay, and if you're homeless, what is the right to vote mean? And what would the right to freedom of religion mean when you are starving to death, okay? So Marxism, was that continuation of the Enlightenment. You can understand where Sartre went from his existentialist philosophy to his Marxist philosophy, okay, because these were all commitments of the Enlightenment, all commitments to human freedom and dignity, even though the Russian Revolution and the Chinese Revolution were themselves, in fact, failures by Marxist standards, okay, because they created and then enslaved a proletariat, okay, rather than freeing people, freeing the proletariat, and freeing humanity overall, which of course was Marxist commitment, was human freedom universally, just like Kant, okay, and so Marx comes out of Kant. Okay. Now, most of you, when you make your ethical decisions and go through your moral deliberations, will probably make your decisions on the basis of a number of theories. You may use virtue theory, utilitarianism, and deontology all at once. Another problem that we have with an ethics course is moral relativism. Now, I've discussed relativism before, so you should be familiar with it. Many people, especially young people today, believe in moral relativism. That is, all opinions are equal, anything goes, you do whatever you want to do, okay, whatever you feel like doing. Now, there is legitimate cultural relativism. In the United States, we tend to use forks and knives and spoons when we eat, and in Japan and China, etc., they use chopsticks. All right, so there's some differences in our culture and our habits and our dress and many things, but that is not necessarily moral relativism and certainly not epistemological relativism, just because societies do some things differently, okay, which is true, okay. The moral relativism says that they can do any sort of thing differently, okay, from one society to another, one group to another, okay, or one culture to another, okay, and that anything would be equally valid, that all opinions are equal, okay. That doesn't make sense, and it contradicts itself, as I hope by now you know, okay. Moral relativism suffers from many difficulties, okay. First, of course, we can say what counts as our group, what society, what culture do we belong in, okay, because we can be in several groups, societies, and cultures at once. Second, there are conflicting views within any group or society about what is right and what is wrong. And third, okay, you have put yourself in a contradictory position, as you know, by saying that what applies to your group is universal, and then on the other hand, turning around and make exceptions for other groups who are different from your own group, okay? So would you approve, say, human sacrifice or the castration of women just because it's done in other cultures, even though you say it should not be done here in the United States? Okay? Would you be prepared to accept that kind of immorality on the part of others, okay, by saying it doesn't matter? Okay. Religious relativism. Okay, religious relativism is again similar to moral relativism. Religious relativism states that whatever beliefs one has, okay, right or wrong, just or unjust, okay, fair or unfair, good or bad, is simply a matter of one's religious group or society, and whatever that group or society deems. Therefore, there's really no place here for reasoning, okay? Okay, now, of course, there are religions in which there have been human sacrifice and animal sacrifice. There are religions in which there have been torture, in which there has been a religious superstition of burning at the stake, witch hunts, okay? And there have been atrocities by religions in the name of religion, as we know, from everything from terrorism to the bad treatment of women in some religions and minorities, etc. To say that all religions simply are equal, which is whatever particular group or practice or culture or society happens to have, and therefore to abdicate any responsibility to think things through critically, okay, or evaluate religious claims in terms of their merits is religious relativism. Okay, the opposite of religious relativism is religious absolutism. Religious absolutism assumes that one's religion is the absolute truth and all other religions are sinful or evil or idolatry. Now we're up to legal reasoning. Okay, we will return to religion in a minute. Okay, legal reasoning uses the same methods that we have been learning throughout our critical thinking course. Okay, so they use arguments, evidence, okay, causal thinking, okay, explanations, etc. Okay, in order to do the law. Okay, so first principle of law is the harm principle. Pretty simple, comes straight out of utilitarianism, and it says things should be illegal when they cause other people harm, such as stealing, okay? That's causing people harm, and of course, therefore, stealing should be illegal. Okay? Next is legal moralism, which says the law should reflect, okay, what is going on in morality. The next principle is called the offense principle. Doesn't mean that you've committed a crime, okay? But the offense principle states simply that things should be legal, okay, and if they are not offensive to people, but things should be illegal if they are offensive to people, such as, say, pornography or vulgarity. Maybe some things are illegal, like smoking inside, okay, and vulgarity or swearing has often been forbidden in much of the media, okay. So there's this offense principle. It offends people, don't do it. You can't do it. It's illegal. And very important legal concept is what we call legal precedent. The legal precedent holds that the law is determined case by case on previous written, what we call positive, okay, it doesn't mean happy, it's what we call written, meaning positive law, okay, when the case is similar. So you use previous cases, evaluate it on the legal precedent to evaluate the similar case that can employ the same laws previously passed. Finally, of course, and very importantly, there's philosophy of law, which is studied as an undergraduate. Okay? Philosophy of law is a field of philosophy, of course, which states what the law ought to be. What is the good? What is just? Philosophy of law has a long history, okay? And it is based upon your legal system, your traditions, your morality, okay, on your conceptions of society and human nature, and of course the aim of philosophy of law is what is justice and how can we get to justice. So we're going to take a break in a minute. Right now I'm going to just remind you that this will be on religion, okay, and we want to avoid religious relativism. We might even discuss that there are some things in religion that are a little neurotic at times, at least that's what Freud's view was, okay, and that there are many things in religion that seem quite contradictory, okay, and therefore, you know, not all religions can absolutely be equally right, okay, but that doesn't mean that all religions are equally wrong, okay, it's simply that we need to use our reason and be discerning, okay, whatever your conception of God may be, okay, you have to look at and examine how reasonable your beliefs are and how reasonable those other people's beliefs are. You can't simply go and say, everybody else is sinful, I'm perfectly right, okay? And not necessarily look at it and examine yourself, okay? Otherwise, you're going to wind up in some very interesting self-contradictory rounds. As Jesus said, look at the block, okay, in your own eye before you worry about the speck in your neighbor's. So if we can have a little break, we will return with Dr. Robert Eisenman, and we will be discussing religious relativism and absolutism in history of religion, and so on. Break, please.
Hey, what's up? I'm Nicole Aaron.
And I'm Zeta. You guys are watching University TV.
Today we're at California State University to make a film,
home of the Torah.
Let's try this next episode.
Entertainment centers and attractions.
So you have to go to the beach. how are you taking out? Five out of 3 is wonderful. Famous colleges, you are there.
Certainly, that's colleges.
The park like sitting on the Cal State Venus Hills campus sits on 346 acres, providing plenty of places to sit or lounge outside and enjoy the California weather. And all buildings are only a short walking distance from one another. You will also find pedestrian paths lined by eucalyptus or other shade trees.
Notice the college on the hill. The campus makes good use of the tree, with many buildings built at varying elevations.
The university enrolls about 12,000 students per semester. It is one of the most ethnically and culturally rich student bodies in the U.S. The number one ethnic group on campus is the majority. The student body is 70% female to 30% male.
Well, after I went to high school, I had my option to visit school, and I did it here. I'm going to be a teacher in California.
Students with GPAs below 2.0 are not eligible for admission.
For California residents, the average full-time annual fee for public university is $3,400, not including the cost of postal housing. Out-of-state students pay about $400 extra per unit. The university offers many financial aid options, including scholarships and grants.
Out-of-state students give you your choice of 45 bachelor's, 21 master's degrees, and 10 teaching credential certificate programs.
Underwater climate investigations, how students are doing, they're developing algorithms, teachers, robots, and take to identify ship luggage, explosives, and so forth.
Some of the students' favorite majors include legal studies, business administration, digital media arts, child development, and nursing.
To work in television or the motion picture or music industries, Cal State Davis Digital Media Arts program successfully prepares students for careers in those fields.
The legend holds true. There's a ghost in every theater. The Dominguez Hill Spirit comes to every play, opens the elevator doors, and wishes the cast good luck.
The university also has the largest master's degree program in conflict resolution and peace building. Plus, the orthotics and prosthetics program is one of only 7 such programs in the nation.
With 687 faculty members, the university has a student to faculty ratio of 23-1.
The university has 11 men and women to draw on for their teams, the NCAA Division II level.
Most college residents have outdoor dormitories. The complex consists of 22 two-story buildings with 1, 2, and 3 bedroom furnished apartments, all with full kitchens. The apartments were originally built to house athletes for the 1984 Summer Olympics.
I do currently live in campus housing, and it's a nice experience. I don't have long hair, just long and quick to do. But also, it gives me the opportunity to interact with people on the court, and it's exciting to meet students in Slim from 60 student members to join or participate in, from cultural and special interest organizations to professional service and honor society groups. There are also 5 fraternities and 8 sororities on campus, some of whose origins have Latino or African American beginnings.
Some lot of students who came home did not see involved in collective organizations, sorors, or friends. But we do have a few snacks, so you'll get a dodgeball tournament.
Addicted to reality TV? Well, here's your reason to get off the couch. The Associate Students Incorporated put activities together for the students every year. Today, the amazing race.
Some of the students include Dan Christen, a
pianist composer who's worked with people like Herbie Hancock and Prince. These international actors whose television credits include Reno 911 and Clean House. And John Reilly, the co-creator and executive producer of the classically entertaining Cops.
For I think Castle of the Hills would be home.
If you're looking for a friendly student folks university where you won't feel lost in a seat and everyone knows your name, be sure to check out Cal State Dominguez Hills in the heart of beautiful Southern California.
Thanks for joining us here in Carson, California
on our campus at California Free University in Dominguez Hills.
Bye.
Well, we are back now with Dr. Robert Eisenman, who is a professor emeritus from California State University, Long Beach, and who is a specialist in religious studies. And Dr. Robert Eisenman was my student. I honestly I was Robert's student many decades ago at Long Beach State University. That's a professor, that's what. Okay, he's quite a character. Dr. Robert Eisenman is editor of the Dead Sea Scrolls. He appears on TV all the time. He's on television this evening on Channel Education Plus. Okay, but he's on television. He's on television quite a lot, and he has many, many books. We bought some of those from the show, that he's really an expert in all these things. Okay, this is like the... Okay, we've got the Dead Sea Scrolls, uncovered, right, because he was editing. Okay, and we've got his very famous book, Jesus, The Brother of Jesus, which I read to some extent quite long. I also listen to these lectures, etc., over the years on these topics. We have the New Testament Code, and then we have several other books of yours, right?
All right, now we have this book that was written about Charles Fogler, that belongs to the Holy Bible, and it's from Paul von Dan Brown, the Christian Code, but it's also been one called the Dead Sea Scrolls
section. Okay.
And our work is about that book.
On top of which, Robert has done, he goes through these archaeological digs through Israel, etc., for the Dead Sea Scrolls. I was invited several years ago to accompany a whole group of students from his famous book. And as well as a faculty member, but I can still go because I used to be a professor of religious studies at Long Beach State. And
I didn't come.
You know,
the teachers who we paid for
it. Right. Well, next time, for sure. Now we're looking at number two. You got the impression that Robert has written many books, many more books than I have. I just have that little critical thinking book out of the dark. Articles. So we have a lot of books, and one of the things that we were discussing in this chapter was religious relativism, which you treated briefly. But another one, and it's a major concern today, is religious absolutism. Much of the author of the topic has something to say about this fundamentalism, extremism.
Well, they all feel that's a good example, right? And the Dead Sea Scrolls feel that these authors are known for and have been involved in, and the formation of early Christianity, Christian origins in Palestine. It turns out religious studies is a very odd field. There are people who do are often ex-priests, ministers, rabbis, things like that, people who have a religious commitment that may not be any honor against them, but it's there in the background. And a lot of people in this field are really under authority. was in Palestine before it went overseas. There, although they had authority, they could only go that far. And the schools, therefore, were pushed way, way back into time so that they had to be pre-Christian, because in their minds, there would have to be both the Christian and the Rabbinic minds. Muslims didn't get involved in this. There would have to be a Christianity in Palestine. It was impossible that they could conceive. There wasn't a Christianity in Palestine. There was just this apocalyptic militantism in Palestine. That Christianity was created overseas. That was very, and retrospectively, back in the Palestine, they could not go that far, and therefore we had a sort of curia of minds that controlled the Dead Sea Scroll studies, interpretation of the Yom Tov scrolls, and that's what you mean by absolute religious authority. These people, as little as they might have felt, they were under authority.
And therefore, they're very
dominant. Their minds, some of them were dominant, they couldn't go beyond a certain point. Because at that point, like a Muslim would to some extent be, he or she could go up to a certain point. But there are certain things they would do and say, I'm paying a bit of that. They would be in serious trouble. We as non Muslims maybe can go a little further, but even we found we can't go beyond a certain point in some people's view. But, you know, they couldn't go beyond a certain point, and that's where the absolutism kicks in. You can talk of course you want within the tradition itself, but then suddenly the tradition becomes absolute.
And then you fail to really look at the complexity, the contradictions, the evidence, and the reasons being
given. And those people who are into relativism, you see, and they say, oh, we've chopped it all off, you know, we're just looking at everything in a comparative way. Getting into a relative situation, those people who are mindset, they don't see, they don't know enough about the religions themselves to know what the religions themselves were saying or were involved in or emphasizing, so their view isn't much better than the ones who are under absolute control. So you're really in a difficult situation where you need this knowledgeable, secular, objective people who know everything they can possibly know about all of the traditions we're talking about. They may be in a position to draw some conclusions, perhaps some judgments.
And you need to have an honest approach towards history. As all these religions come through with documents, as well as rituals and traditions, you need to be able to look at those documents with an open mind and understand that they are translations that were written for a particular audience at a particular time in a particular historical context, often with a political agenda.
Pauline theology, Greek mystery. in a life in the past, burn backwards into it in a retrospective manner, but the practitioner is not aware of that and can't even come to it. I'm not a professor in college, just like you did. And he was wonderful, and the one thing turned out to be an anti-conservative religious Catholic Christian, but if I'm not doing it in college, he was a free thinker. He went the other way, but what he used to say to study my mind on literature is literature was truer than history. And what he meant by that was he worked for the literature is truer than history. What he meant by that is it's not what really happened that matters. It's what people think happens that matters in theater. This is usually presented in the form of religious texts or what.
Right, and then what they often do at most in certain Christian studies is that they don't even understand the context in which the text is written. Or, and therefore, they may actually not recognize there are battles that are heretical battles that are going on, that there are subtleties and there are nuances and there are contradictions, and therefore can take over dogmatic positions that actually are heretical or in conflict with actual traditions. For example, perhaps, okay, the notion that, well, Jesus died to forgive your sins. Well, that wasn't necessarily the original understanding of the death of Jesus. It was taken over in many ways hundreds of years later. And it started as that's why there was the crucifixion. And they spent all these layers and we built up around the death of Jesus, which are distorted over the mind body duels that came out through Gnosticism.
There you go. Okay.
Yeah.
What you say has assumed there's a Jesus. You know, and this is not what Jesus is necessarily saying. First, you see, this story is capable of proving there was a real Jesus, and not just an abstract spiritual ideal personified like the Greeks personified wisdom in Athena or enlightenment in Apollo. Here we have a salvationary figure. The name salvation in Hebrew, Yeshua means salvation. So it's the same concept personified in the moral perfection that they were trying to write in the not in the Judaic manner, but in the sort of Greco-Roman manner.
Whether they vote, or whether they become terrorists, or their attitudes towards women, or whatever, there are huge consequences to their belief systems because they're not really looking at reason or how they're being controlled or manipulated by those authorities that they so trust and believe in.
I'm not sure we've had any more problems in the present than they've had in the past. They're publicized more to the people in our community and on the abortion and anti-abortion people and already contacted you. So they were, you know, they would do the article. Anyway, without publicizing it, so I'm not sure if it's any more than take the Islam world, you know, something new in Islam to have, you know, a suicide and terrorist bombs for the good of the revolution or for the change or the furtherment of Islam. It's a modern phenomenon, but it does go way, way back into the roots of Islam, back in the early parts of the struggle with the Crusaders. You had these terrorist sort of people who would literally commit suicide and assassinate people, and they were called the assassins. So these situations have been there for, you know, centuries, maybe a millennia, and nothing that even an awkward scenario here we're going to make it.
Well, no, but it is a concern because in terms of self-awareness, you need to be aware of when you see all these things going on with other people, maybe you to yourself have thought of certain kinds of religious assassins or religious relativism. Most historical thinkers I'd like my students to be thinking about.
Well, you're doing, as a university teacher, as a teacher, it will be fair enough because it has to take for more than 6 months or 2 years or 5 years. And something like you were saying, the young people are going to go back to their knee-jerk reactions. But if they're born particularly as they get older, it's known that people admit that they go back to being who they were when they were young. So, I mean, it would be arrogance on our part to think that we're really affecting anyone very, very deeply, except the one or two people here and there who gets really deeply into this matter. So I think they're rank and file are partly touched by what we attempt to do.
Characterizes many people that they reason things through. But we hope so because part of the commitments of the Enlightenment were that we would use some reason now and then to decide ethical political issues as well as religion.
But you're mixing something up here. You're telling people who walk through the Enlightenment walls and walk through the streams of thinking that it went into it and came out of it and influenced those ones. But you're thinking that by telling people these things, you're going to influence them and the movement is all that matter. The only thing you can afford is to tell people what it was, what happened, and what came out of it, but you can't think this is going to have any effect on anyone's mind at the moment. That your judgment maybe is the fact that it's on some people, but you seem to want to say, well, if I teach these things, then they'll be able to better evaluate where they are, and so on and so forth. I think that's pretty much of
some people do have certain commitments to the Enlightenment, some to the state, right?
Have you met some people like that?
Well, you know, we talk about equality here.
Well, because you inhabit a philosophical world and then more a historical religious world, I've never heard people speak about any of these things.
Okay.
That is the small minority of people in the world that you encounter that are still talking to these terms and realize that there are some fossils still out there. Talking that way, but most people I hear, they sort of more talk like Ronald Reagan.
Oh, yeah.
There you go, I just did it, it's a life under
the sun. I have some friends who are very interested in philosophy and also politics and politics and economics.
Karl Marx, all the sins that have been attributed to him, he did it in one sentence.
Well, thank you. That's the.
I was going to ask you, of course, you're always a beautiful big elegant thought. You were not only there. I mean, you know, what happened to some of his descendants in Germany, Hitler, whatever, not the Regal, did they? They missed their contest from the university. It's really quite shocking that they all mind of all these great. Moral imperatives, or whatever you want to call imperatives you're talking about, should have forgotten basic essence of it.
Well, that's, of course, that's what Sean Cole's Arthur's basis was, is that these people were really bad things. We had it like machines on tools in the state, and went around and did all these terrible things saying, I'm not responsible, it wasn't my choice, I'm not free, I was just doing the good German.
Making money, they can take nuclear aid, but it doesn't mean that there's no optimism about the solution. was the largest in the U.S. community in the U.S. or America at that time. They wanted to find out what the Americans had to offer and found that this was an ID system because it was pure egalitarian.
Right, and actually after the American Revolution, that made a very big impression on a number of people and they started the French Revolution, the Asian Revolution, and then of course eventually that even led to the Russian Revolution. And there's a connection philosophically with the ideals of these
parties. Right, so they bargained. The Russians were into this extreme alcohol with the Bolsheviks and finally managed through cleverness and maybe some help from the German opponents. Bring the Russians out of war to get them in there in place that was more ruthless than the other guys. I think the Russians were really looking for a liberal, progressive democracy. And they got what we now can see is a really almost a thugism on the other side of the coin to German Nazism. It's a weird form of autocratic, it's not Nazism as such, but it's a weird form of some form of totalitarian thinking. The reason we can't stand up to them is that they, having a platonic dictatorship, if you like, the dictatorship of the philosophers of kings, they can see where everything should be in vernacular, where we have to live with them on in Medicare at the moment, in the Congress, the medical debate. We have to live with all these excruciating debates between all people that differ from each other in the slightest matter. They end up putting themselves apart in two houses of Congress, and then they have to reconcile that the president has to get involved. The system is so complex, it may not be able to stand up to the challenge that these totalitarian regimes like
Russia
and Islam came about. Should have never developed a capitalistic Islamic caliphate. Capitalist and communist government in China, we may not be able as a freely entrepreneurial capitalism to stand up to them. And that's where your enlightenment philosophers might not stop.
Now,
here's the reason to resolve these tremendously difficult problems. It's way out of my scope. I'm just talking off the top of my head here.
Yeah, there are some very deep concerns.
Thank you. I'm a woman that leads. All of my friends, I introduced you to Nietzsche. I'm a philosophy guest. And you are the perfect Nietzschean. The only difference is for Nietzsche, as you could quote, he had the idea that silly thing where he said, no, that was the woman, carry light with. I think you just reversed that, but I think it was the man carrying light. If you guys are the founder of the man, then Nietzsche would be quite happy with that, because I think you really like how he died, by the way. I remember how he went finally crazy. Some fellow off streets of Jordan or something like that was whipping up a horse. And then he ran up and took the horse in his arms and started crying. That's lovely because I was disagreeing with your presentation while I was listening to it, where you were talking about enlightenment and women, of course, were all equal and so on, and being concerned about whether it's good for a man or what about animals. People think that animals have to be brought in.
Oh, absolutely.
Kind and humane and not humane, but put them to death. Maybe not to be humane in treating these poor creatures that are at our total mercy in a tender, compassionate way. I judge people often on how I see them with animals.
Right, well, Martha Nussbaum, the great philosopher of the States, she has a little book out on Kant and on Rawls on the theory of justice and deals with the problem of animal rights, environmental rights, and the rights of the disabled. So she said, Kant and these people really never even took this into consideration.
Take care of animal suffering, that's all I know. I mean, because animals are like people used to be considered, the lower class groups, those are like animals, but they had no rights whatsoever. They were completely at the mercy of the upper classes. Now, most of the classes have a little bit of leeway. But animals are totally dependent upon us. They're the ones who have been escaped because of what? Because these came in the dream. Paul was living like we're in the movie theater, chained in a cave, and they're on the wall, and only the philosophers see the truth, and they go out and see the light. The poets and the myths in which the average person lives in, for him, is the world of the dark. So this is to me where I agree with Professor Orr Whitehead on that, where all things philosophical tend to start.
Probably goes through, and actually is one thinker in terms of religion, because he's involved in process philosophy, process theology, where he doesn't get trapped either in the relativism or in the absolutism. So a lot of my students want to get them through Whitehead.
You are probably the only person in the universe teaching Whitehead in any consistent manner. I mean, but this is actually an incredible version.
Actually, my chair also teaches someone.
That's not fair. That's your robotic it's more law and not your medical department. Because tell me some other departments that are cheating Whitehead as a principal thinker.
No, I'm afraid. There are many departments.
So your audience man, that was one of Whitehead's favorite students.
Oh, okay.
So remember that famous story about Griffin's
son? Yeah, when she was dying.
Yeah, when she was in his class and she wrote, "I don't feel like good writing today." And he said, "Oh, and then the exam, he was writing, but the guy, I think, was he said, "Oh, that's all right, my dear. I understand. I often felt that way myself."
So I think I'm right back to Plato. Plato sets it all up by saying that what we need are universal truths, universal morality, something that transcends society, that was not relative to Buddhism.
Therefore, the whole Western thought can be thereafter, but it's not biblical thought. It's not Western thought. It's not because the Christianity is simply that they consider themselves part of biblical thought in the way that Muslims are part of a Quranic book. They wish that they can tell me that aspect of the tradition that they represent. Obviously, it makes that clear in others, but the point is that he set this up, but the Bible and Quran and other documents that I can have this view of the world that I think biblical scripture and Christianity so tend to, that if you live like this, you're going to go into this heavenly existence. They lay it out in a literary manner, all of what is required, so to speak, that you be and do it. People know that even if they're all going to die and turn into rotten bones, he's in the last moment when they're not going to think that they're actually going to get to where it was been promised them, which is a very comforting. You don't know essentially, life is so short and so fragile that it really helps them get through.
Yes, I'm sure that it does, but there are other traditions too, so one of these orders.
My mother went to college and she studied philosophy, and obviously she learned a thing, but before she died, we said, oh, this is fun. But, all these shows, she went, what did you teach? What's the matter in college, mom? She said, I can't stand cat.
Well, he actually is a major.
Well, Schopenhauer was. That's all she ever
heard. Everything about Kant represents what we call the anthropological turn, or that is, philosophy moved from being theocentric, God centered, right, to being human centered. So we can see there were early stages of philosophy, like the Greeks, which were cosmological. And then, of course, with the rise of Christianity throughout the Middle Ages, philosophy was primarily theological, theocentric. And gradually we get the scientific revolution, which very much is influencing the Enlightenment. And then we get humanism from the sources, right, from the Renaissance as well. And then we get this change of ideals of what it means to be human, the definition of human nature, and what is right and what is wrong, and what is a good society and what is not a good society, based on these commitments of the Enlightenment, which changed the world.
If the Enlightenment brought about the changes in Europe that you were documenting in the 1700s, 18th century, starting early, thought about this one, but you see what they've done is something quite frightening in certain ways. Because literally, it makes perfect sense, it sounds reasonable, it sounds like it ought to be, all these rights should be respected. There are some things that have occurred, like the death of Columbus and this kind of thing, but what has happened, all of this mess that we encounter between natural resources and inflation and holding people hostage, you know, the colonialists have had it all worked out right or wrong, and then finally the other thing that has occurred, you know, the fact that democracy has been thrust on countries that are culturally level where democracy can function or should have been introduced outside of capitalism first. What happened in Germany after the First World War? Democracy produced Hitler. You will get these economics, usually Hitler, President Putin, and people like that, Chavez and Venezuela, rising out of the mass because they have charismatic being about them. And democracy doesn't necessarily solve the world's problems.
Mike, really, what about kind of recessions of Palestinians and democracies and so on, and all of a sudden you wind up with terrorism?
Themselves. I want to throw one other thing about this
Yeah.